Line now by Soul Asylum. They're here to have a laugh and sing a song. Please say hello to Dan, Dave, Carl, and Charlie. Hi, you guys.
Hey.
Hey there.
How's it going?
Going pretty good. You know, this is a whole new thing for us.
This meaning this whole kind of satellite hookup thing here?
Yeah, and then like, you know, playing a song and then casually chatting and then playing another one. It's like, what are we doing?
Well, I often ask myself that.
We'll just pretend like we're hanging out in the Zone 105 basement, you know, just having a couple of Cokes and sitting around and playing guitars and stuff.
Right on.
That'll work.
More or less what we're doing.
Okay, good. Good. Well, now let's talk about the new record. It's Candy from a Stranger. And I think it's safe to say that this is a highly anticipated release, wouldn't you?
I hope so.
I'm anticipating it.
It is by us.
In my life, it is. Okay. I'm featuring it in my life.
Well, I guess the question I'm asking is, you know, the last two records have done so well, Grave Dancers Union and Let Your Dim Light Shine, both, you know, beyond platinum. Is there pressure for you guys to succeed with a record like this, or are you able just to take the old regular approach to every record you do?
Well, people put the pressure on you, not, you know, and none of us get Billboard or SoundScan. None of us even have computers, you know, so we're kind of out of that thing. And for us, it's just you want to play music that's fun to tour on and fun to make and feels like it's from your heart, and then it's the record company's job to go out and sell the record, and we kind of wash our hands of it when we deliver it. We say, here, do what you can with this. Good luck, you know?
Right. Are you guys happy with it?
I think it's good. I love it. I think it's real fun to play and to listen to.
Well, we're going to hear a song from you in a bit. I just wanted to ask about the departure of Mr. Sterling Campbell. I mean, I hear that it's amicable, but also, you know, it's starting to look like, granted you're early on, but are you guys going to go through one of those Spinal Tapian drummer things where it's absolutely impossible to retain a permanent drummer?
We're not going to let that happen. And that would just be, it's just too much turmoil. Sterling was great to play with, and we all understood that he wanted to move on, but it's just trying to find the person that is going to be the one. It's not easy, and it's not something that I would wish upon anyone.
I got you. Okay, well, and now who do you have there with you today that's playing drums?
Charlie Quintana.
Drum roll, please, sir.
Got him napping back here.
Wow. But he's quick on the sticks. Nice. Thanks a lot, Charlie. Appreciate that. All right. Well, just to get the silly, sensational stuff out of the way, now, recently it came out that your song Misery showed up in the Tommy and Pamela Lee sex video. My question to you is this. Were you more shocked to find that your song was in a sex video, or were you more shocked to find out that Tommy Stinson had appeared in a Puff Daddy video?
The Tommy Stinson thing we'd heard about, because his drummer Gersh was a drum tech on this record. So down in Florida, Gersh pulled this tape out and he goes, "Man, check this out. What do you think of this?" And I go, "This is, you know, what's first?" My first question is, "What's a Benjamin?" That's a And once I got over that, I was like, "I thought it sounded really great." You know, I think Tommy had to be kind of talked into it. It was a story Gersh tells, and then once he started to do it, he was having a fun time. But I wish, you know, more people played together. It seems like there's a lot of disparity in music. I think it's great when stuff from left field meets stuff from right field, and it works.
I think Tommy Stinson's just glad he didn't end up in the Pamela Lee video, so...
I'll trade him any day.
Right. So what are you guys going to do about that? I mean, it shows up. You didn't even know about it till recently, and you find out that the song Misery is playing in the background while... let's not even think about that. What are you guys doing about it?
We're kind of trying to... figure out what we can do about it, because it's pretty annoying, you know. So we'll see. We're gonna kind of figure out what our rights are and take it from there, I guess.
All right, good enough. Well, we're talking to Soul Asylum here. It's Zone 105. The new album is called Candy from a Stranger. You guys gonna play something for us?
Absolutely.
Excellent.
We're gonna do I Will Still Be Laughing, as heard on Zone 105.
Close, stand in the punchline.
Asylum on Zone 105. That is I Will Still Be Laughing from the new album Candy from a Stranger. We've got Dave, Dan, Carl, and Charlie filling in on drums for now. You guys are still auditioning drummers, correct?
Hello? Wait, yeah, they're running back to their microphones or
I'm
something.
I'm sorry. Do we need to give you more time in transition here?
We're back now.
Great. Well, can we ask you guys to stick around for a little bit? We'd like to talk to you some more, maybe hear another song.
Absolutely.
Yes, we will.
All right. It's Soul Asylum live on Zone 105. To prove how many... Zone 105, Brian Oak and Steve Nelson. We were talking to them before. They've been kind enough to stick around. It is Soul Asylum. Hi, you guys.
Hey.
Hello.
Hello. Now, before we dive back into things here, I know we got another song from you, but you guys are from Minneapolis. I mean, it's where, you know, everyone here still considers you a hometown band, whether or not you guys are, I don't know how, you guys still live here? Some of you, all of you, most of you?
Yeah. All of us.
We've got places to go back to, yeah.
Okay.
We're neighbors.
Very good. Well, you know, you guys are involved in a lot of other projects. There's a lot of other things going on. You never know when you might just finally cut those ties with Minnesota.
Yeah, I think it would have happened by now.
Okay.
Well, I think you're stuck with us.
It's a little too late.
Yeah, it's just fine from this end. Actually, last summer, when Grand Forks got ravaged by floods, this is just a killer story. Because I would have loved you guys to play at my prom. You played at the Grand Forks prom because their prom was postponed due to major flooding. How did you guys come about that? How did that come about, or how did you decide to do it?
We got offered the gig. We were pretty honored. You know, it was like four different high schools, and they asked for us, so it was great to just, you know, be able to help them out and just do our thing. And it was a pretty fun experience. You know, we got to kind of ride in on white horses and play the prom.
Well, their prom's a bit canceled, and they had them, what, an Air Force base? Is that right?
Yeah.
All big the old hangar.
Designers designed or donated dresses, and they decked out this place. And you know what? It was one of those things that sounds silly, but it was really, really special. It was just like, you know, talk about a bad year.
Right. See, I don't doubt that for a second. I mean, you know, if you guys would have played my high school prom, I think the band that played my prom was Party Time.
Flight Time, you're thinking, aren't you?
No, I'm afraid this was Party Time. Smaller still.
I got Flight Time and you got Party Time. Who won that bet?
Yeah, exactly. Well, you guys, actually, you know, it's interesting because the first time I ever saw you guys play was at the Great Hall over on the U of M, and you were opening up for the Urban Gorillas, and so it's just interesting to see how fate and time work out.
Yeah.
I'm glad it's interesting for someone.
Yeah, okay. All right. Well, it is. It's certainly interesting for me. You guys are coming back to town now. You're going to be here for Edgefest 5 for sure. You're going to be playing at our big summer show coming up at the end of May.
That's what I hear.
That's true.
Now, when you guys come back home, you know, knowing that this is where you're from, this is your hometown, people here love and expect a certain something from you, is it nerve-wracking at all? Is there anything different about playing in front of the hometown crowd?
You get more people wanting to be on the guest list.
I was a little nervous when we did those shows at Midway Stadium a couple summers ago, but generally, like playing at First Avenue or the 400 Bar, I don't get real nervous there. How about you, Dave?
pretty much a lot of...